We have often heard secularism defined as separation of religion and state, and a government which is neutral or equidistant from all religions. In this way, secularism is also defined as religious freedom for all religions. There are some issues with these, however. First one is the definition of religious freedom. It is described as freedom to believe and to be free to practice your religion. But can someone really be allowed to practice their religion with full freedom? Every country, whether secular or not, has laws that prohibit certain practices in public and private. Every country wants to enact laws that they feel are ethical and beneficial to society on the whole. Consequently, we see that certain religious practices and certain forms of speech are routinely banned all over the world. From polygamy in US to unstunned slaughter in Sweden, the niqab in France, the minaret in Switzerland, confessional parties in Portugal, the refusal of several European countries to allow Scientologists to self-identify as a religious group are just few examples where secular states do interfere in religious expression. This dichotomy arises because they define religious practice and beliefs simply as the freedom to believe something in your head and to perform rituals in your place of worship. Everything else, such as public expression of religious values, right to organize politically, struggle for enacting religious laws in parliament, are subject to deep secular scrutiny and, as we saw from the examples above, never granted entirely, if at all. This becomes particularly acute when public expression of religion conflicts directly with secular views on gender, sexuality, free speech, etc. One such case was that of Kim Davis in the United States. Davis, a county clerk, refused to abide by the Supreme Court decision legalizing same-sex marriage in the United States. When she refused to issue marriage licenses on religious grounds, she became embroiled in the Miller v. Davis lawsuit. The second issue with the definition of secularism is the separation of church and state simultaneous with profession of equal rights for all religions. What about rights of those people who do not believe in separation of church and state? The separation in the US was meant to protect religious institutions from federal interventions. However, as we saw in examples above, it now means banning certain religious ideas from public and private life. Not all ideas, but certain. This stems from the belief that religion should be a personal matter, and anyone who does not believe that is overstepping the line. It is true that one cannot and should not compel someone to accept someone else's religious beliefs, but this should not be weaponized to ban public expression of religious ideas. Doing so would deny people equal rights. Third issue is with the idea of equal rights themselves. Can we give equal rights to someone who indulges in religious hate speech against other sects or religions? No, we cannot, and the right to free speech would be restricted. Can we put in jail people for giving comments perceived as sexist, misogynist, ableist, etc.? This has been the practice. This brings us to Popper's paradox of tolerance, where he famously said that for a society to remain tolerant, it must show intolerance to the intolerant. Going in depth, he meant those who use physical force and violence to impose their ideas. John Rawls stated that intolerance should only be resorted to against the intolerant when the security of the tolerant and institutions of liberty are threatened. As you can see, these become very open to interpretation. In France, the niqab is banned, even though women who wear the niqab are not being intolerant to anybody. There is no single definition of harm or of liberty. We do not hence know what should be tolerated and what not in every case. Some people bring rationality as an objective solution. As Amartya Sen has argued very coherently in The Idea of Justice, there is not one path of rationality. Things can be irrational, irrational, and completely rational, but often we find multiple strands of rationality. So how do we proceed forward? Firstly, secularism and tolerance need to be stopped being used interchangeably. While certain secular countries do provide a lot of liberty to religions, others put religious people in concentration camps, banning their clothing, and used government surveillance to persecute millions of adherents in their lands. Historically, we have also seen the acts of Stalin and Pol Pot. Even today's liberal countries, hence, do not give complete freedom, equality, and tolerance to all people. In fact, nobody can. Secondly, it must be recognized that secularism is just one of many systems of government that have certain red lines. No system offers absolute tolerance or absolute free speech. Thirdly, the word freedom must be replaced. From free speech and actions, we must move to reasonable speech and actions. A bird shifted from a smaller cage to a bigger, luxurious one is still not free. So why do we call it free? Reasonable speech is a more honest term. Lastly, academic debate and discussions should be encouraged at the level of society as well as government. Notice that I use the word academic. This filters out rhetoric. Not everyone can be given religious freedom, but the state banning some freedoms should be preceded by that community demanding it themselves for its members. Before that, civil society should keep on engaging with different groups. Writing down secularism in our constitutions may or may not increase tolerance in society. Look at India, secular by constitution but ravaged by Hindu majoritarianism. This writing down is unfortunately encouraged by those who believe in these incorrect interpretations of secularism and wish to impose it by force on unwilling people. Tolerance can only be achieved if we involve more people in debates and discussions and let the truth defend itself.